Hi.
Hi. I'm sitting here with the inimitable and esteemed Dr. Jordan Peterson. If you haven't been following the last couple of years, you might be hiding under a rock or surfing some other slipstream dimension. So I don't want to go into too much detail, but I'm very honoured and privileged to be able to have a bit of a conversation with Dr. Peterson today. There is just one or two questions that I'd like to ask you. With regards to the fiasco with the Cathy Newman interview, mm-hmm. and talking about journalistic integrity and how that sort of ramped up what you were talking about yesterday in the VIP area about the media now sending out a memo saying, well, this is not how to do interviews. What are your thoughts? Can you elaborate on the demise of journalistic integrity or the death of journalistic integrity?
Well, I don't know so much if there's, if you can characterize it yet as a demise. It's certainly a transmutation, because journalism is taking all sorts of new forms. It's emerging in many new forms online, in print, and also on YouTube and in podcasts. We're definitely in the midst of a technological revolution, and I think that there's a proclivity on the part of the traditional media, let's say, to panic, to fail, and to use increasingly desperate means of attracting attention. Well, that's occurring. And it's easier to attract attention in the short term with heavily polarized views and opinion pieces and that sort of thing. And it's like clickbait, I suppose.
That's right.
It's the mainstream media equivalent of clickbait.
Right.
And it might be a reasonable short-term strategy, but it's a deadly long-term strategy for any credible news organization, because credible news organizations live and die by their reputation, and reputations are easily lost. And so I think that what happened with the Channel 4 interview was an example of journalistic reputation being lost, because there was almost a complete disconnect between the person that Cathy Newman thought she was talking to and me. And, you know, she should have noticed that. I would say, let's say she had reason to be hostile and suspicious to begin with. We could give her that, but hypothetically, by a few minutes into the interview, 7 or 8 minutes after four or five questions didn't go the way that she thought they might go, it would have been much more appropriate for her to default back to a normal conversational tack instead of treating the encounter like a forum for victory.
Right.
So, and I think that was her mistake fundamentally, and the mistake of many journalists is to think about it as something, as a forum to attain victory.
Almost like a journalistic jousting that she was asked.
Yeah, it was a dominance hierarchy maneuver match, essentially.
Yes. Yeah.
So, and I didn't want to play that game particularly. So
when there was feedback afterwards, and she had said that she thought the interview went well, and she didn't know what the raucous was about, and mm-hmm. what Yahoo was about, do you see from a Jungian perspective, because that's my background, mm-hmm. as a Jungian, I'm looking at it from, is there the capacity and the propensity for self-reflection? Does the person not see at all?
I really don't know. I mean, I would say, if you're thinking about it from a Jungian perspective, that it was a good example of animus possession.
Right.
You can see that quite, there are many examples of that online. I've actually thought about making a video about that, because an animus possession is a thing that's very difficult to describe, but you can see it, and certainly that's what happened with Cathy Newman. It was blatantly on display. I really don't know how she has responded to this. I don't know how you respond to something like that. I tried to put myself in her shoes and to imagine that I was the recipient of, well, let's say, well, it's a worldwide negative publicity, essentially, and thousands of cutting comments, you know, ranging from pretty damning to extraordinarily damning. And I mean, there's the odd comment that is in favor of what she did and stood up for her combative nature and all of that. But I just don't know how you respond to that psychologically. It's got to be, you either shut it out, which isn't helpful because you don't learn anything, or you let it in which case it has to be devastating. So,
Is there a notion of, if we go back to the Jungian perspective, of perhaps the transcendent function coming into play, where you are trying to hold the tension of opposites, but you're actually not doing that effectively?
Well, the problem is, I think, in her situation, is that because that interview failed so dramatically and so publicly, that for her to bridge the gap between her current persona, let's say, and the reality that was manifested in that video would require a very comprehensive personality overhaul. And that's a very unpleasant thing to do. There's a lot of falling apart and burning away that accompanies that, because it isn't clear to me that she was wrong on a superficial level.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe she was having an off day. Like, it's possible, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think that that video would have had the carrying power it had if it was merely indicative of an otherwise competent journalist having a bad day. It seems to me that it was a manifestation of a style that she's used quite successfully in the past, that has had its short-term expedient advantages, but that is not a credible strategy for someone who's playing a deep and honest game. So there's a lot of, my sense was that the video indicated that there was a lot of work to be done, but not only on her part, because, you know, she was involved in that personally, but she was also the mouthpiece, let's say, of an entire organization that was oriented towards having her do exactly what she did.
Right.
And the, you know, what I expected to happen was that, well, I have the interview and then Channel 4 would chop it and cut it according to their tastes, which is essentially what they did for the broadcast, and that the rest of it would disappear. I think it was unbelievably naive of them to put it online, but they did. And, well...
Do they credit to some degree?
Well, I don't think so.
No.
Maybe. I think it was more, they thought it went fine, and then didn't understand what the fuss was about. And then, were they genuinely outraged that she was, quote, victimized? Or was that just a cynical ploy to spin the narrative in an acceptable direction? I think, you know, a little of column A and a little of column B. So, but that also failed, which was quite interesting, because for about 4 days after the interview, the narrative, the victim narrative, was picked up by many newspapers and spun hard, you know, that there was security threats and that she was now in danger, and there's no credible evidence for that whatsoever. But that came out, and there was a flurry of activity around that, and then that just got criticized to death and disappeared as a strategy. So
would you say that it's possibly part of the collective shadow manifesting and projecting itself, and media has just become the torchbearer for...
Well, I think that's often the case, right? I mean, the media chases as much as it leads.
Yeah.
And so it's a positive feedback loop between the media and the populace. I mean, that's partly, I think, what's driving polarization is exactly that. And I think that the interview was an example of what's driving polarization, and that's partly why people sat up and took notice of it. It's like, really, this is where we're at? It's like, oh yeah, this is...
I mean, is there a place to bridge this polarization through perhaps the Jungian perspective of holding that, the tension of opposites, and being able to see critically both sides? And I there's a philosopher that I followed for years, Daniel Dennett, who's saying that if you're wanting to engage in a discussion with someone and move or progress the conversation forward, that there are some steps to that, including, you know, always what you say in chapter 9 of your book is act as if the person that you're talking to or you're listening to has something to offer.
Mm.
And it didn't seem apparent that that was the case in that interview.
Well, that's the mistake, I think. Well, first of all, the two people who are engaged in the process of dialectic, let's say, have to be of goodwill, you know, and they have to be oriented, I would say, towards peace. And they can be oriented towards victory, but then, of course, that's a combat. And it isn't, perhaps it's sometimes the case that there are times when one conversation should be combat, but it's not very often that that should be the case. Most of the time, it should be, what would you call it, peacemaking that you're devoted to, because especially if you're discussing something important, and it should be assuming that you're able to trust the other person, which means they have to bring goodwill into the situation. What you want to do is bridge the gap, because that's what forestalls conflict, right? If you can't solve the problem, then what you have is you have conflict. That's it. So and maybe you're ready for that, and that's, I suppose, if you're ready for that, well, then that's how it goes. But a wise person will talk for a long time before they engage in actual conflict. So,
when you're speaking of conflict, do you think that in times of crisis and chaos and conflict, that certain archetypes rise up and spring forth, like perhaps the trickster archetype or the
Well, that's Milo Yiannopoulos.
Yes, Milo.
You know, and comedians play that role all the time, and comedians play a disproportionate role on, you know, on YouTube, I would say, in guiding the dialogue. Most of the people that I know that are astute political commentators on YouTube and who've attracted a large following, have a very large number of them are comedians.
Would you call yourself an archetype? Because you do. Last night I was watching.
No, a wise person makes sure they stay dissociated from the archetypes.
Okay, mm-hmm. Even if it gets put onto them, because you do seem to be the penultimate father figure, the surrogate father for many young people.
Yeah, well, that's not too bad. That if that's the archetype, that's not too bad. You know, I mean. That's I'm of the right age for that, and my discussions to people are salutary. So that's a reasonable role to play, I would say. There's not too much psychological danger in that. So.
And just one final question, yep. Just in terms of your meteoric rise in the last 2 years, I'll just say, how has the stardom been? I mean, I was out there in the line queues yesterday, even just escorting the Archibald Painter down. He said, well, he's quite handsome. He's quite a good-looking fellow in real life. Young men were quivering at the knees yesterday saying, oh, my gosh, I've just met Jordan Peterson. Elderly women were like, wow, I wish he wasn't married. How do you take all that with a grain of salt, with humility, knowing that there's a spectrum between humility and hubris? And I do know that you have close people in your that
well, I'm, you know, I was a psychotherapist for a very long time.
Yeah.
And you get accustomed to dealing with variants of that, I would say. I mean, you stay detached. I don't mean detached in that you don't care. Mm. But you have to stay outside the drama in some sense, I guess. Like, it isn't that you don't take it seriously, but you see it for what it is. You know, if people are starstruck, they're struck by a projection of their own imagination, in large part. You know, and I can see that in people's faces. I try very rapidly to get over that. You know, so if someone comes up to me and they're nervous and they're sort of, let's say, starstruck, for lack of a better word, I can usually eliminate that immediately because I just talk to them very directly, and then they calm down, and then we have a conversation. And that's much better. It's much better.
So. Yes, I do see you doing that. You are very intent, and you listen so well. Dr. Peterson, I am very grateful and thankful for you having done this interview with me, and I really appreciate the synchronicity. Again, I'm going by Jung a lot because I'm a Jungian, but the synchronicity of being here and being allowed to do that, do you find that that's a part of your life as well?
Which, the synchronicity? Oh, God, you have no idea.
I would love to hear a story. I've heard your ghost stories and the tap-tap in the boot of the car and the owl. And you didn't go further into that, but I'd like to know if you care to share a story.
I can't. They're too complex to lay out. Most of them have been associated with frog imagery, I would say. But I can't say more than that because it's just too complicated. You know, it's like trying to explain a dream. It's very, very hard.
Well, I remember the dream that you recounted of being on the chandelier in the middle. Did you end up resolving that?
Yeah, well, I would say everything I've done since that dream is probably a resolution of that. I mean,
Thank you so much.
All right. Very nice to meet you. Nice talking with you.